Mansfield.
The Ridge Racer series died in 2012. It barfed out a couple of mobile releases in 2013 and 2016, but that was some Weekend at Bernie's shtick, sticking crutches under the series' armpits and holding its head up to make eye contact when people paid it any attention. What was once the prime example of the new world of video games had already peaked, fizzled, tried to spark up something new, failed miserably, and smashed straight into a wall. At 90 miles an hour, without a seatbelt on. But why? What happened to Ridge Racer? Ridge Racer! Remember that one?
Remember that one?
Let's have a look back over the series. Most of it, at least. Nobody's got time for all those daft mobile versions.
Ridge Racer!
1993 saw the launch of Ridge Racer in the arcade. Namco's coin-munching behemoth was a ludicrously good time in those smoky halls of yore. Or the bowling alley where I played it, at least. Thumping techno, fast-paced and exciting action, an amped-up announcer. You rarely lasted beyond a couple of minutes, but it didn't matter. This was pure arcade joy. It stuck with you. More so if you played the full-size car version of the game, which I will admit I never did, despite it being in the arcade at Meadow Hall in Sheffield for years. I think it was a fiver a go, which was too rich for my pauper's blood. But while Ridge Racer was a fab arcade game, it was in taking the leap from coin up to the home where it became a legend. Namco ported the title to Sony's brand new We Don't Need No Nintendo machine, the PlayStation, with the cunningly titled Ridge Racer landing the same day as the console in every territory the PS1 released, from December 1994 through to September 1995. Now, it helped that by and large the PS1 wasn't riddled with astonishing launch titles, but that's not to take away from the accomplishment of that very first home-er. Arcade Perfect is a wee bit off the mark, but for all intents and purposes, to the eyes of the layman, well, it was Arcade Perfect. Something that rarely happened outside of the Neo Geo back in 1994. Ridge Racer nailed it. It was fast and fun and exciting. It had the techno that thumped, the announcer who was amped up. It had it all. It was an instant legend in Sonyville, and with good cause. The series continued back in the arcades, a straight-up sequel, Ridge Racer 2, and a third game in Rave Racer, with both developing the formula a bit, not much. A rearview mirror, force feedback in the wheel, better graphics, that sort of thing. But the tilt had already started tilting. The arcade was no longer where Ridge Racer belonged, and as players started to flock to those coin-up emporiums in fewer and fewer numbers, plenty more still turned their attention the way of the PlayStation. Which, frankly, saw a bit of a damp squib on its hands with Ridge Racer Revolution in 1995. I mean, I enjoyed it, sure, and it's not like it was critically panned or anything daft like that. It was pretty good. But Revolution felt like an expansion pack in all but name, introducing a few wonderful elements like link-up play and the Angel Car, but largely feeling like a rehash of the first game. But while Ridge Racer Revolution wasn't a revolution for the series, the wheels were turning. The metaphorical ones. I mean, not just the ones on the cars. Of course, the ones on the cars were turning, that's the entire point of cars. Rage Racer, Rage Not Rave, hit the PlayStation in 1996, and it was here where we started to see what could happen with a series built with the home console market in mind, rather than one still with one foot firmly stuck in appeasing its arcade homeland overlords. Rage was still recognisably a Ridge game, despite being called Rage, and so it's fair to say there were voices hooting out in 96 that this wasn't different enough from what came before. I wasn't one of them. Rage Racer pivoted visually to a moodier, darker visual tone, something more appealing to my teenage brain. Admittedly, I go for blue skies every day now, but the past is a foreign country. Rage also added in simple progression mechanics in the shape of credits, purchasing cars, and upgrading the cars you owned. Depth. Bliss. So we'd started in and left behind the arcade, before heading down a new road towards proper home console-ified racing games. More feature-rich, more depth, more replayability. While all the Ridges, and the Rage on PS1, had been at the very least good fun, they hadn't quite nailed the formula. Step forward 1998. Oh, and the game that came out in 1998, Ridge Racer Type 4. Type 4 did nailed the formula. It mixed the pivot in style from Rage Racer expertly with an even deeper, surprisingly stylish Grand Prix mode, wherein you could unlock some 300 plus cars while playing as one of a number of different teams. Where Ridge Racer's previous had been fantastic to play in the most part, and while Rage had upped it in this respect a fair bit, it was Type 4 that absolutely hammered the player with the richness of its atmosphere, engaging you like never before in a sexy, stylish world of arcade drift racing. Type 4 didn't have the same feel as the original Ridge Racer, sure, but it clearly built on those foundations and was also brilliant as its own thing. Ridge Racer maintained its spot as a wonderful thing too. They were both wonderful. But Type 4 really stamped its mark on the PlayStation. It was a pure home console game, neatly weaving together the satisfaction and purity of arcade racing in with the more involved and personal journey of progression. Something that could last 5 hours rather than 5 minutes. So it was that Ridge Racer Type 4 was the peak. The best Ridge would be on the original PlayStation and one of the finest games the platform ever saw. Even though I didn't include it in my personal list of best PS1 games a while back when I did that video. And Type 4 ended up being the series' farewell on the home console that had made it the success it was, with the PlayStation seeing no further Ridgey games. But what a legacy behind it all. This was a series that had a couple of peripherals specifically produced for it in the NegCon and JogCon. Yes, they worked on other games, and the NegCon was made for Cyber Sled, really, but it was the Ridge Racers the controllers were inextricably linked to. And if you do have a spare JogCon line around, I'd be happy to give it a home because it's genuinely not a terrible controller. Point being, the Ridge Racer series was one of the true greats of the PlayStation's catalogue and held incredibly close ties to the platform. But just like Tomb Raider, Crash Bandicoot, and plenty of other would-be monogamous franchises, the Ridgey one started looking elsewhere. And it was about this point things started to take a turn.
Ridge Racer!
Ridge Racer was born in the arcade, but it was on PlayStation where it grew up. But like all ingrate children, eventually it decided to spread its wings and bugger off to other non-Sony formats. The first non-Sony home format to bag a Ridgey surprise was Nintendo's 64th console, the N64, which welcomed Ridge Racer 64 to its stable in space year 2000. It was based around the original Ridge and Revolution and brought together plenty of cars and tracks and more in what amounted to a genuinely fun package. Unfortunately, three things would work against RIIIIIIDGE 64. The N64 was home to plenty of popular arcadey racers already, and Ridge had its work cut out just to make itself known. This version wasn't based on the bar-raising Type 4, and so did feel like something of a step back for the series as a whole, even if Nintendo owners wouldn't necessarily feel that particular hurt so badly. And three, Space Year 2000 was the end of the road for the N64, and the original PlayStation, and whatever else was out there. The PlayStation 2 was about to stomp into view and make everything obsolete. Ridge Racer 5 launched with the PS2 a month after branching out to Nintendo and, alright, it didn't make everything obsolete. Plus, to be fair, it took 8 months to arrive in the West owing to consoles back then not having simultaneous worldwide release dates. But yeah, while it was a showcase of the console's ability to throw out jaggies, RIIIIIIDGE did also manage to make a good case for itself. It leaned more towards the original Ridges in overall structure, but still took a fair few cues from Flagbearer Type 4. Only problem being it just wasn't as good as Type 4. Ridge 5 looked better, sure. It ran at 60 frames per second, a first for home consoles in the series. He says, ignoring the tech demo of Ridge Racer Turbo, they did 60 frames per second on the original PlayStation, you ruddy fool. Ridge 5 had structured championships and reward cars and a handful of neat little secrets to unlock, but compared to the game 2 years prior, it was shallow, almost to the point of feeling empty. And just like the N64 game, the PS2's debut Ridge, and ultimately only proper Ridge game on the console, fell flat because it was being compared to a superior predecessor. But it wasn't just not living up to what came before. These games weren't bad, they were well received, they're still fun to this day, blending straightforward arcade racing with pulse-pounding presentation. I'm sorry I said that out loud. No, Ridge Racer was suffering that horror of all horrors. An audience that was losing interest and had moved on to other, shinier things. When Ridge Racer 6 hit on Xbox 360 in 2005, the fact it was the first mainline Ridge game not launching alongside a PlayStation console, and in fact never appearing on any PlayStation console, was about the only murmur of real interest that came out of the whole escapade. Ridge 6 was, again, a good game. Arcade fun, a career mode, unlockable cars and secrets, loads of tracks, online multiplayer, it had all the ingredients. But this was a changed world. 1994 was over a decade ago, and a game from 1998 was still making modern Ridge releases eat its dust. Contemporary racing titles like Project Gotham Racing 3 were staking their claim to an audience hungry for a bit more of a simulation-adjacent bent to their racing fun. And those who were just looking for pure brain-off arcade fun had seen their minds thoroughly blown with 2004's Burnout 3 Takedown. Just as the original Ridge Racer had changed what it was players expected from racing games in their home, Burnout 3 had done the same again. Expectations were way beyond what Ridge Racer 6 delivered, and while it was fun, it was a game out of time. A year later, in 2006, the series went back to doing what it did best by launching alongside a PlayStation home console. Ridge Racer 7 ran at 1080p and 60 frames per second on the PS3, something most games on the system wouldn't do throughout its entire lifetime. But other than that, well, this was Ridge Racer 6.5, really. There was an initial splodge of popularity for the game, and again, it was good fun, but the attention just wasn't on the series like it had been a decade prior. MotorStorm was wowing PS3 owners despite a lie of a trailer. Need for Speed had built itself into a juggernaut of a racing franchise. The next Gran Turismo was already being hyped up, and we were only a couple of years from the next Burnout, that being Paradise, which would once again raise the arcade racing bar. Ridge Racer wasn't a part of the conversation anymore. The zeitgeist had left it behind. Could it have worked out differently if Namco had focused on building upon the foundation set by Type 4? It's not like that game was just a critical darling. It sold over a million copies, so surely could have been a framework to riff on and grow out from. But no, apparently not. Things were watered down, the game's playing public's attention drifted off elsewhere, and Ridge Racer on home consoles was left meandering, lost in the mix, and holding little of the cultural cachet it once had.
Ridge Racer!
While Namco seemed dead set on not introducing any particularly interesting or experimental elements to the core Ridge series on home consoles, the studio did dare to branch out on a couple of titles through the mid-noughties. In 2003, the PS2, GameCube, and Xbox welcomed R Racing Evolution to their respective libraries. Literally minutes later, it was forgotten. Alright, I'm being mean there. R Racing Evolution was Namco's attempt to branch out into a slightly more simulation-focused world of racing, riffing on the likes of Gran Turismo and Project Gotham Racing. Real-world cars featured, and you were able to tune and tweak them to get the performance to the level you needed it across road and rally races. Problem was, the core racing was all a bit empty. Losing the ridiculousness of the arcade racing in the core series was a killer blow here, and the resulting game was one that simply blended in with the crowd. That's not to say it had nothing going for it. A core storyline ran through the main campaign, and while it wasn't going to win any awards for, well, anything, it offered enough of a novelty to keep you pressing on through the rather dull racing just to see what happened next. And, to be fair, the psych-out meter appearing above opponents' cars, filling up as you drafted and pressured them in races, ultimately forcing them to lose their cool and make a mistake, that was a cool idea. But beyond that, empty. The other spin-off came in 2005 with the Japan and PS2 exclusive Critical Velocity, a cross between GTA 3, Driver, Final Fantasy, and featuring approximately one car from Ridge Racer. I did an entire video on that one game, so rather than relitigating its existence here, I will instead try to remember to link it on screen and just settle on the summary of 6 out of 10 didn't live up to its potential. You may notice, though, that I've been deliberate in the language used here when referring to Ridge Racer on home consoles. Well, that's for a good reason.
Ridge Racer!
While Ridge Racer was meandering through the main series on consoles and failing to do much of note with its spin-offs, the world of handheld gaming actually ended up being fertile ground for the franchise to attempt a rebirth and claw back some of the popularity it had lost elsewhere. I'm not talking about Ridge Racer DS Mind, which was a bit pump. Nope, I'm talking about Ridge Racer on the PSP, known under the better title of Ridge Racers in Japan, which launched in 2004. And typically for the series, it was indeed a launch title on the handheld, such a cute little tradition to have. Ridge ER on PSP wasn't merely a cute tradition though, it was an absolute banger of an arcade racing game. Content-wise, it acted as a sort of best of for the series as a whole, bringing cars, tracks, and music from previous entries to the series together in one glorious whole. Mechanically, it was superb. Drift-based arcade racing with tight, responsive controls, challenging and sometimes annoying AI opponents, and all set in some superbly well-designed tracks. There were plenty of modes, including a challenging single-player Grand Prix featuring plenty of cars to unlock, as well as online multiplayer for when you wanted to lose horribly to actual humans who were always better than you at any game you ever tried to play against them. That may just be me, mind you. The PSP version of Ridge was also the first place to see the addition of the Nitrous feature, first added in Ridge 6 on home console. While not a new thing for racing games as a whole, this one tweak was enough to lift the entire racing experience up another notch or two. Boost was rewarded for successful drifting efforts, and while you couldn't earn more boost while boosting, you would earn boost faster than normal if drifting under the residual speed you'd be hurtling at when your boost finished. I realise this sounds boring and dumb when explained, but what it translated to in the game was a delicate balance of building, using, and quickly rebuilding your boost meter throughout races. Another layer of skill on top of managing your drifting, navigating opponents, memorizing tracks, and not throwing your PSP out of the window when some computer-controlled dickhead blocks you off yet again. Boost was a simple but superb addition that helped Ridge Racer on PSP no end. And, it's fair to point out, this was a game that managed to lift itself above the "but it's not Type 4" critique in the most part. While it didn't feature a story or style akin to the PS1 Master, nor did it have anywhere near as many cars, etc., and so on, it didn't really matter that much. Why? Because the game was tight. The near-perfect balance of pick-up-and-play fun, ever-increasing challenge, enough going on to keep you playing a while, and technical chops. So it was no surprise to see a sequel in 2006. What was a surprise was the critical reception, which was significantly cooler than it was for the first PSP game. Reviewers and players were simply disappointed in what was seen as more of the same, a very slight upgrade that mainly focused on throwing in more cars and tracks as well as a couple of new modes, rather than vastly reinventing or really improving anything about the first game. It's a fair response, it really is. People had waited a couple of years for the sequel to a genuinely great game, and when it came out, well, it didn't feel like 2 years of work had gone into it. And yet. We live in the future now, and Ridge Racer 2 is easily the better of the two games. This is an example of where the contemporaneous reception was way too steeped in the expectations of the time. Understandably and fairly. But this isn't 2006, and we haven't had to wait with bated breath for a sequel we've put massive expectations on to arrive. We have the run of the place, and yeah, Ridge Racer 2 on PSP is phenomenally good. Take all the wonderful mechanical aspects of the first PSP Ridge, add in a crap load more tracks and other bits and pieces, and you ended up with the ultimate best of compilation for the handheld. I digress a wee bit there, but it's worth pointing out because a cursory glance across the internet might have you thinking Ridge 2 isn't absolutely fantastic when it actually is. Ridge Racer 3D on Nintendo's 3D handheld, the Nintendo 3DS, was half decent too. It brought too few new ideas to the table compared to the PSP games. I'm aware of the irony of saying that given I just went to lengths to explain why actually Ridge Racer 2 is the best one despite it recycling loads of stuff, but hey. RIIIIIIIDGE 3D was a fine, if forgettable, entry to the handheld pantheon, and actually was one of the handheld's best games at launch, to continue that particular theme. So while Ridge might have been floundering on home console, it was finding its feet and excelling in the world of handhelds. It seemed there was a perfect new world for Namco Blamco to leap into with all the best of intentions, one where we would carry the best versions of a legendary arcade racing series around with us in our pockets, bags, and bindles. Nope. Ridge Racer did continue on handhelds, and it did once again launch on the same day as a new system and push things from a technical perspective to wow early adopters of the device. But, yeah. 2011's Ridge Racer landed at the same time as the PS Vita, and what should have been a triumphant return to form for the successor to the PSP games was, instead, a lesson in god-awful nickel and diming. Reviews around the Vita game's launch were less than stellar. In fact, one heroic, handsome, and completely modest reviewer wrote the following. "The rumors are true. Three tracks, five cars, no single-player career. It's all tied into your online team. Ridge Racer is an experiment into how game content is delivered to gamers, and just like MX vs. ATV Alive, it misses the entire point of what it's trying to do. If you're going to release a glorified demo, don't do so for £20. Do it for free. Top the content up with paid DLC later, you will get more fans as a result, instead of a response of resigned discontent. This is a very stupid idea, and the Ridge Racer you get in the box is half a game, and half a boring game at that. It shouldn't be so, but Ridge Racer 2 on PSP is far and away the better game of these two, and that came out years ago on a technically inferior system. God, even Ridge Racer Revolution trumps this one on the fun factor. It's so bland, empty, passionless. Even the overenthusiastic announcer sounds like he's phoning it in. Decent online integration and interesting team-based systems are welcome and show off some of the Vita's strengths, but the damage is already done. Until a real package is released with a full game available at a reasonable total cost, there is very little worth bothering with on Ridge Racer Vita. Released for free, this would have been an interesting experiment, if still backed up with a boring, chugging racing game. As it stands, it's the latter point mixed in with a £20-shaped slap in the face. Absolutely pointless. 48%. I genuinely forgot I'd reviewed this at launch, such as the life of a former Superstar Games journalist. All the same, I do agree with Pass Bransfield, who was bang on the money with this half-page review. Ridge Vita was at best pointless and at worst a slap in the face. Any handheld hopes built up by the PSP and 3DS games were comprehensively destroyed by the Vita release. And it didn't exactly get much better back in the home, where Ridge saw its first entry on consoles in 6 years, and first ever release for the series on PC, with 2012's Ridge Racer Unbounded. The last gasp. Blomkai Nando's final chance to make a Ridge Racer game that reminded us of just what was great about the then nearly 20-year-old series. So naturally, Unbounded was almost nothing like any of the Ridges that had come before it. Its closest relative in the franchise was probably Critical Velocity, and even that was a tenuous link at best. No, this was a game very much riffing on the style at the time, mixing Burnout with Split Second and Need for Speed Hot Pursuit to make for something that was legitimately decent fun. Fast-paced, chaotic, often gorgeous, sometimes thrilling. But not Ridge Racer. Drifting was bashed off to the side in favour of destruction and car-based violence. Endearingly over-enthusiastic race commentary was replaced with a try-hard air of super-cool style. In a supremely PS3 360-era move, a Japanese dev team was replaced with a Western one. It wasn't right, it didn't feel proper, and people reacted accordingly. Unbounded was absolutely fine as a game. You could play it and enjoy it. But two things. One, it was unmemorable outside of an awful name. B, Hot Pursuit, Burnout Paradise, and Split Second were all better, so would be vying hard for your attention, and Secret Entry 3, unless you saw the title of the game, you absolutely would not recognize Unbounded as a Ridge Racer. The series had changed its look, its style, its vibe over the years, but it was always recognizably ridgy when it got out on the track. Unbounded was very clearly a game by the developers of Flatout, with Ridge Racer's name slapped on it, shunted out to Europe and the US, without Japan, the home of Ridge, even getting a sniff. The whole thing was just off. It's not that Unbounded was disrespectful to the series' legacy, or a shockingly bad game, or anything of that hyperventilating ridiculous criticism. It just didn't do anything other better games weren't already doing, and it felt like a cynical pivot to try and cash in on the popularity of where racing games had been going over the few years before its release. Attitudes had changed, attention was focused elsewhere, and the market had moved on. Ridge Racer Unbounded wasn't bad, a lot of people still stand for it to this day, but compared to the feeling, compared to how impressive the very first Ridge Racer was on PlayStation, Unbounded was all just a bit embarrassing. A try-hard follower instead of the bold leader of the pack. The hype didn't stick, the attention didn't arrive, the sales didn't follow, and Ridge Racer very much died there and then. There were some other efforts. Like I said earlier, I just have no interest in covering the mobile versions of Ridge Racer, of which there were a few. By all accounts, some were half decent, but I still will never care. This was a series born in the arcades that grew immeasurably on home formats, attempted to spread its wings on handheld formats, and ultimately skidded, smashed, crashed, and burned. Ridge Racer was once at the vanguard, the new wave of arcade racing games selling us a bold future of what we could expect from our digital poodle-mobiles. It made itself a tradition over the years of helping to launch a bunch of consoles and handhelds with games that pushed the system they were on in those early days. But somewhere over the years, Blando and Alrizian lost focus, and the publisher ended up passing the series around, trying to find a developer that fit, ultimately playing catch-up in a race it never had a chance of winning. It was sad to see Ridge Racer die a slow, spiraling death, and it's a series I genuinely miss to this day. But there are few who lived through Ridge's beginning to its end who would disagree when I say it wasn't unexpected to see it go. Maybe one day it'll come back, but I for one would not be surprised if Ridge Racer stayed as dead as it has been since 2012. No, the mobile games still don't count. Thank you for watching, and extra special thanks to these here patrons on Patreon. You can join them through the link below and become a part of our monthly woodland get-togethers where we all stand in a circle wearing robes screaming, Ridge Racer!
Ridge Racer!
I'm off to see how easy it is to scrub a line you just said from a video because it was a complete lie. Bye!
Ridge Racer! Alright everyone, 1 minute to go. Are you ready? The engines sound like they're ready to go. Are you all set?
Remember that one?